Hi, good morning and assalamu alaikum. You remember that a week before I posted a video in which I gave you an overview of clinical evaluation. And I promised that we will take all those segments one by one and we will elaborate on it. Now, just for a recap, if you remember, I told you that you are here and this is the diagnosis. Now, in order to reach the diagnosis, we have to pass through a step-like process. The first step is history. And history was what a patient knows about his or her disease. So whatever we get from the patient is actually history. And this is the foundation on which we build up the subsequent story, which is then general physical examination, local examination, systemic examination, and then investigations. And then we actually narrow down our search to reach at a diagnosis. Now, in this small segment, we will be elaborating this portion, the history. What is history? Actually, one of our teachers said that if a patient came and a doctor was not able to make a diagnosis, and then another doctor came and he was able to make a diagnosis, the difference between these two were that the first one was a very good history taker. He knew the skills of history taking. Some people will argue that in this era of scientific development, when we can find out whether it is direct hernia or indirect hernia through investigations, and ultimately we have to explore it, what is the purpose of doing a ring occlusion test, and what is the purpose of doing other finger invagination test, etc., etc. Well, my argument will be that they always form a basis of good understanding, and moreover, just relying on the investigations, which are very, very important, though there is a possibility of missing some vital informations which cannot be judged by investigation alone, and they require actual interviewing the patient and also physically examining the patient. Now let's take this history. So, and I would like to just explain it in a kind of a real life scenario. I'm sitting in my clinic and a patient just walks in. And when he walks in, our assessment of reaching up to the diagnosis actually starts right from there. And for that, a technical term is used, which is actually an English word, which is demeanor of the patient. Demeanor of the patient, in some extent called demeanor or demeanor of the patient. Which means that just on first look, what information you get. And I always tell to my students and residents, and I also try to practice it myself, that before really start asking questions from the patient, we have to see the patient from head to toe and just try to make an impression. Now, there are a lot of informations which actually you get even before you start the history. For example, if someone is coming and he's breathing like this. So before even asking any question from the patient, you know that this patient may be having a cardiac problem. This patient may be having a respiratory problem. Because if he has climbed the stairs up to reach at your office, this is enough to make him breathless. So that means he might be having a cardiac problem, or he may be having a respiratory problem. Similarly, if someone is coming and just on one look, you see that his face or her face is kind of a round face and the cheeks are little protuberant and the skin is little shiny. So you may think of that this patient may be in a steroid overload. This may be a patient of a Cushing syndrome, or this may be a patient who is taking steroid for any other reason. Maybe joint disease, maybe for his bronchial asthma, or for any other disease. Similarly, if someone comes, his nutritional status, you can just assess from the pallor of his skin whether he is having anemia. You can also pick jaundice very early if it is very deep jaundice. Similarly, the way he is walking, if he sits in the chair, and as he sits in the chair, he just sits like this. So for 9 out of 10 cases, he's suffering from some kind of a perianal problem, right? Not only your visual impressions actually gives you some clues about the diagnosis, but if you just come close to the patient and you can hear some whistling sounds when he is breathing. So there is some kind of an obstruction going on inside. Similarly, sometimes very loud bawl sounds may be audible. We remember one of our late professors, Professor Abdul Rauf Khan, everyone knows in Pakistan. He was Professor Emeritus in Nishtar University. There was a saying about him that he can smell the disease. Because once, you know, he was sitting in office and a lady came and he immediately said, take him to the gynae department. So they said, what happened? He said, she has got a typical, peculiar smell of carcinoma of the cervix, right? So it was actually very famous that he can smell the disease. And that is how true it is. Sometimes if someone is actually having vesico-vaginal fistula, lady, and her clothes are soiled with urine, you can even smell it without asking a question. Similarly, purulent infection, different bacteria have got different type of smells which you can smell it. Now, so my message to you is that before you actually start taking the history of the patient, please make a head to toe very critical evaluation. And apart from these medical knowledge, a lot of other social informations you can get about his socioeconomic condition, about her educational status, sometime even the locality, the clothing he is wearing, the ornaments a lady is wearing, the other type of customary things which are actually visible on a patient can tell you a lot of information. So this will be my first thing to start in a history taking. Just have a thorough look at the patient from head to toe. What type of shoes he is wearing can tell you whether this patient is going to pay you the fee or you are going to examine him free, or this is the patient to whom you will pay the fee, because in our profession, you know, all three are possible. It is possible that you pay the patient because you know that patient cannot afford the medicine. So this is the first thing. After that, then you start taking the history. Now, you must have read in your third year and your preclinical classes that the first thing in the history is particulars about the patients. You start with your introduction, you take patient's introduction, and then you take a consent of the patient. Nowadays, it is very important that there should be a formal consent. In most of the clinics, this consent part is done by the secretary outside the clinic, where there is a written document where they say that you give a consent that you will be examined, you will be asked questions and things like that. But it is always better that you verbalize it as well. So normally what I do is I just say, I greet the patient and they tell, my name is Javed Iqbal. Most of the time when they come to your clinic, they know it. But if you are working as a resident in a ward, it is important that you will introduce yourself to them first. Hello, I'm Mr. Fla Fla Fla. And I'm working here as this is my credentials. And I'm part of that team which is going to examine you. And this is why I'm actually asking the questions and examining from you. And then you start asking patient's introduction. And patient's introduction means basic things which are clerically needed for the clerical purpose, but they also have got a link with the understanding of reaching up to the diagnosis as well, right? Patient's name. In European countries, normally patients, I remember, they are called or written with their second name. But here in Pakistan, India, I don't know about Bangladesh. I'm sure in all these countries where, the same type of culture there is, usually patient's record is stored in the form of father's name or husband's name. If it's a female, so father/husband's name. And if it's a male, it is father's name. So it is very important to record both these information. I remember a patient in an operation list many years back, it happened. There were two patients, both of them were Razias. And one of them had to have cholecystectomy, another one had varicose vein. So they said, the attendant just brought a patient, Razia. And then Razia came in and that patient was actually having varicose vein, but her Cocker's and seen. It was a long time ago. At that time, laparoscopic cholecystectomy was not. I was a resident at that time. Now, thanks God, I was not involved in that team, but I could. So they did a Cocker's and seen, and later on they realized that this patient actually was the patient on which the varicose veins has to be removed. So name is very important for record. Moreover, we require the name because we have to communicate the patient, we have to fill the charts, etc. And age, obviously, and because the diseases, they have got, you know, kind of a predominance in particular age. For example, if someone will come with bleeding per rectum and that patient is 60 years of age, I'll think of carcinoma. If 10 years old boy will come with bleeding per rectum, I'll think of different diseases, right? If a elderly gentleman will come with a stoppage of urine, I'll think of prostate or see a prostate maybe. And if a young, you know, 30 years old gentleman will come with retention of urine, I'll think of some strictures and some kind of inflammatory process. And if a young boy will come, I'll think of some congenital diseases or maybe a stone blocking it. And a female will come, I will think of retroverted gravid uterus, right? If very elderly person will come, I'll think of some medicines, I'll think of some neurological diseases. So although the presenting complaint is the same, but just age actually makes the difference. And of course, you note the gender. As we know that the diseases which are related to genitourinary system, obviously they are different in male and female because of the different in anatomy and physiology, but the diseases of the organs which are common to both male and female, in them also there is certain diseases which are more common in one gender. For example, if you have got 10 patients of thyroid diseases here in our geographical circumstances, 8 out of 10 will be female. If you have carcinoma of rectum, then most likely it will be male. Ischemic heart disease more commonly in male, right? So this is why some diseases are actually related to age as well. And then of course we want to know their profession, and some diseases are related to profession directly. I mean, if someone has got a chest problem and he works in a cement factory, that it has got a relation with it. Someone has got carcinoma of bladder, bleeding per urethrum, and he's working in some kind of a chemical factory, this may have a relationship with it, right? And then we may ask about the marital status of the patient. This is more important in female as compared to male, because the marital status actually changes the pattern of some of the diseases in female, but we would also like to know the marital status. And nowadays, either a telephone number or an email, that is very important. And here in Pakistan, we also write down the national identity card number, because it's a unique number, and through that you can identify the patient. So these are certain particulars of the patient which are required when we initially start the history of the patient, and they are very important to be remembered. And they are not just for the clerical purpose, they actually give you some information also which may later on help you in reaching up to the diagnosis. Now, once you have done that particular person, the most important thing starts, and I will just discuss that, and then we will stop this video. In the next video, we'll be talking about the third point, and that is presenting complaint. For me, if this is a tent, presenting complaint is the central pillar of that tent, and I will shortly explain why. Presenting complaint is a problem which brought the patient to the hospital, right? After knowing that this is a 40 years old school teacher, mother of two children, lives in that locality, otherwise healthy, has come to me with, and whatever starts afterward is the presenting complaint. Now, I have done this exercise so many times with the class, and I just present myself that, look, I'm a patient, ask a presenting complaint. So I just do that sham exercise here in front of this camera too. From a student, I asked, okay, ask a presenting complaint. The student will say, what's wrong with you, please? What brought you to the hospital? I said, I have got gallstones. And most of the students would say, okay, so since how long you have these gallstones? I would say 1 year, right? And they would say, okay, what other things you have? No, I will just stop them and I'll tell them, no, this is wrong, right? Similarly, another scenario. Please ask a presenting complaint. You would say, okay, what's wrong with you? Say, well, I have got a pain here in my neck, and I also feel a lot of weakness, and I'm not able to walk properly, and my appetite is also very much disturbed, and I've got a severe backache as well, and I don't know what's wrong with me. And suddenly the student would ask, okay, since how long you're having this? So I would again interrupt them. I would say, no, this is wrong. Because presenting complaint can only lead you to a diagnosis if it has got these important six ingredients. I'm sure they must be written in the books, but somehow I have just devised it in this way. The first ingredient of presenting complaint should be, it should be the problem which brought the patient to the hospital. For example, if someone walks in your clinic with a big thyroid here, walking like this, and you ask from him, okay, since how long you have this? This is about 5 years. Okay, so is there any problem? Yes, I have got little tension over here. Okay. And anything else you have? No, nothing. You have got a heartbeat, rapid heartbeat? No. Okay. You have weight loss? No, I don't have a weight loss. Okay. What about your appetite? Appetite is fine. Anything else you want to tell us? No. Okay. So you do these tests, T3, T4, TSH, blah, 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 blah. And patient will come back with all those tests and found to be that patient is euthyroid, and you book him for the operation theater. And you just do an operation. This actually happened many years back in one of my, areas of my knowing. And patient underwent thyroidectomy, and operation went fine. And next day when doctor came and said, how do you feel? He said that my problem is still there. Like, what was the problem? I cannot swallow anything. Now that poor patient actually had carcinoma of esophagus. But since she also had a thyroid, so she thought it is because of that. And doctor was not shrewd enough to really understand that. Now, if, for example, if he would ask from the patient, what's wrong with you, sir? You have got this gland. And the question would have been, why you are here in hospital? Then it was possible that patient would just volunteer that actually I cannot swallow anything. And if, for example, if it is told to a doctor that there is a patient who can't swallow, the first thing which will come in his mind will not be thyroid function test, but it will be barium swallow or an endoscopy, and you'll be able to diagnose it, right? So please remember, whatever patient presents to you, you just find it out what brought the patient to the hospital. He may give you an investigation. Well, I have got gallstones. I have done ultrasonography. I have done 3 times during last 4 months, and this is my disease. Still, I would ask from him or her, Okay, fine. I'll just look at this. I will look at all those reports. But please tell me that why you have come to the hospital. And if he insists, it is because of the stones. Okay, fine. But why actually that bothers you? What's wrong with you because of stones? And you will be surprised to know that patients say, actually, I have got a lot of pain in my lower abdomen here, and I went to a doctor, he did an ultrasonography, and he said, you have got gallstone. This is why he said, just consult a doctor, this is why I've come to you. Right? Many of the time, when you try to find out, you will find that that investigation has no correlation with that problem which actually patient needs to be addressed. Okay, so what brought the patient to the hospital? Now, the best way to do it is like this. Okay, what's wrong with you? And he says, okay, I have got pain here in my upper part of the abdomen. I would just stop over here. I would say, okay, your problem is that you have got pain here. Please point your finger here. Okay, you have got a pain here. Now, apart from that, what else you have? They say, okay, I have got vomiting as well. Okay, so you have got pain here and you have got vomiting. Two things. What else? Said, along with that, I have noted that I have got fever as well. Oh, so you have got pain here. You have got vomiting, you have fever. Anything else? No. You mean you have got 3 problems. One for which you are seeking the help. One is pain, and other one is vomiting, and third one is fever. There's nothing else you actually want the help for. And when patient says, no, full stop, these 3, get confirmed, and these 3 are the presenting complaints. And if patient keeps on saying, I have this, so keep on listening to the patient, till actually he or she says that, no, I have no problem. So that now you can just judge and you can decipher that which one is the problem which brought the patient to the hospital. For example, someone, what's the problem with you? I've got cough. And if you presume it, that cough is the presenting complaint, you may be fooled. Because when you ask, since how long you have cough? So I've got last 15 years because I'm a smoker. So, but what brought you to the hospital? And then, with detailed probing, you may find out that patient actually had blood in the sputum last night, and that has brought the patient to the hospital. So it is hemoptysis which is the presenting complaint. It's a blood in the sputum which is presenting complaint. It is not cough. So this is first point. What brought the patient to the hospital is the starting point. It is not what actually patient tells you. What is actually, what has brought the patient to the hospital? This is one requirement. If your presenting complaint does not fulfill this requirement, then you will not be able to reach the diagnosis properly. For example, in one example I gave, patient has this, patient has this, patient, and you said, since how long you have this? So what are you asking? Which one? Right? Patient may be thinking that you are asking that since how long you have got pain in the legs, whereas you think that the sense of weakness is I'm asking. So this is why, unless and until you are not very sure about the problem which brought the patient to the hospital, you cannot move forward. The second thing is that a presenting complaint is a presenting complaint if it does not have a medical terminology. If any medical terminology is uttered in the presenting complaint, it is not a presenting complaint. I don't know whether people in Europe are and those who are English-speaking countries, they will be watching this video. Here, I'm sure it's in India and Bangladesh as well, in Sri Lanka and other countries. There is a term called Bawasir. Bawasir is actually an Urdu translation of hemorrhoids. But in my experience, a patient who has hemorrhoids, perianal fissure, perianal fissula, anal fissure, perianal fissula, CA rectum, anal warts, pruritus ani, or maybe even no disease, he would say Bawasir. And if you ask from patient, what's problem with you? And he says Bawasir, and you think it is hemorrhoid, you'll be wrong in more than 70% of the cases. Similarly, if patient says, well, I have got malaria, I have got cholera, I have got gallstones, I have got heat in my stomach, these type of funny things patient tell. I have burning sensation in my bladder. Right? A patient, people who have got little medical knowledge sometimes say, oh, well, I've got peptic ulcer. A patient just start telling you the diagnosis. If he utters, or I've got stones in my kidney. If patient utters any medical terminology, this cannot be a presenting complaint. You have to further ask a query and convert it into an English, Urdu, or any other non-medical language to understand what has brought the patient to the hospital. So first thing, it should be the problem which brought the patient to the hospital. Second, it should not have any medical terminology. And the third requirement of presenting complaint is, it should be an objective statement. I hope you understand the difference between objective and subjective, right? Something happens to me is a subjective complaint. I don't know what is that something, right? There are certain terms which only patient can understand. Or different people will understand it differently. For example, I have got indigestion. And if you presume that indigestion is the presenting complaint, well, if you ask from six people, different people, what do you understand by indigestion? Some people will say, if I have got belching, it means indigestion. Some will say, if I have got sense of fullness, I have got indigestion. Some will say, if I have kind of a vomiting after food, or I have got something comes out in my mouth after food, this is indigestion. Some would say simple distension of abdomen is an indigestion. So no one actually has got, and it is not possible that everyone has got the same understanding of indigestion. So this is why any terminology which has got a subjective feeling cannot be the presenting complaint. It has to be an objective statement. Objective means everyone understands same meaning of it. I have got problem in my tummy is not a presenting complaint. I have got pain here is the presenting complaint. I hope I made this point. So three points. It should be the problem which brought the patient to the hospital. It should not have a medical terminology. And it should be an objective statement. And thirdly, it should be in patient's own language. That is important. Sometimes we put our words. Patient said, I have got pain here. And you write it down, colic in the right flank. Patient never said colic. And when you write down a note as colic, and your colleague will immediately get an impression that this might be ureteric colic. So whatever patient says, but this also does not mean that whatever non-medical things patient will tell, you will just start jotting it out because I told you that it should be in patient's own language, right? What I'm stressing over here is that we don't add our own sentiments into it. Because sometimes patient tells a very funny thing. I have got pain here because of gas. This gas goes here and then it shifts over here. And then it goes here in my neck and then my head feels very heavy. And unless and until I don't take some soda drink and don't belch thoroughly, you know, that gas does not come out and I have got headache. Now, you must be laughing and you must be smiling. But story is funnier than this. Sometimes patient tells you non-anatomical things. So you have to decipher yourself that which you have to include and which you have to omit. Okay, so this is point number four. And point number five is that they should be, if they are more than one, they should be in chronological order. For example, if patient had a mass here, pain here, and jaundice. If pain occurred first, then the jaundice, then the mass, it is something different. And if patient had jaundice first, then mass, and then pain, it is different. Right? So, just the changing the order of the symptoms actually changes the whole clinical scenario. So, it is very important that if presenting complaints are more than one, they should be in chronological order. The problem which occurred the first, that should be described, and then second one or the otherwise. And the last thing is that a presenting complaint has no meaning practically if it does not have a duration attached to it. For example, someone had swelling in front of neck for the last 30 years. And someone had swelling, he's a 50 years old gentleman. And someone has a swelling in front of neck for the last 6 months. For me, if that swelling has not caused any harm for the last 15 years, most likely it is not going to cause any harm for the next 15 years as well. But the one who had this swelling at the age of 56 months back, that is ominous. That is dangerous. So duration is very, very important. Someone has a lymph nodes over here for 2 days and someone has got 15 days has got importance. So is the case with all the symptoms. Right? So, to sum it up, why I said that presenting complaint is the central pillar, because every presenting complaint will generate a list of possibilities in your mind. For example, if presenting complaint is swelling in front of neck, the possibilities which will generate will be different if the presenting complaint was difficulty in swallowing. So if correct presenting complaint is there, the possibilities, and out of these possibilities, one will be the diagnosis, will be correct. And if, for example, your presenting complaint is wrong, it will generate the possibilities which may not include the diagnosis, and hence you will miss the diagnosis. This is why presenting complaint is very, very, very important. Moreover, each presenting complaint will generate a diagnosis. And the subsequent, which is history of presenting complaint, etc., they will be dependent upon what possibility came in your mind. So if the possibility which came in your mind is not one of the diagnoses, then you will ask wrong questions. If you get wrong questions, how do you expect to get right answers? So in other words, I don't know, all of you know the geography of Pakistan. I live in Bahawalpur. On one side is Karachi, on another side is Islamabad, we are somewhere in the middle. If I think, and there's a city called Lahore which comes between Bahawalpur and Islamabad, if I think that Lahore is actually on that road which goes to Karachi, and I start walking it, with each step I will be away from my destiny. No matter with how much dedication and how much hard work and how much honesty I move towards it, but I will be going away from my destination. So if your presenting complaint is wrong, your subsequent clinical assessment will be on a wrong direction and you will not reach the right destiny if you're going on the wrong direction. We will stop here because I know I have done the analysis of my videos. You know, I just spare 15 minutes in the night to just see it. So I've seen that even if the content is very, very strong, if it is more than half an hour, the viewership is less. So I don't want to bore you, and I know very well I work in radio as well, you know, for a literary program, and I know it was taught to us that the maximum attention span is 7 minutes. After 7 minutes, the presenter has to change the topic and has to put some kind of an ice break, otherwise people will not understand. So I will not make this video very long. I'll stop here, and next time, in next video, we will be discussing how to take the history of presenting complaint. And the last message is that if you have not yet, you know, subscribed this channel, you can just subscribe it. And also, because the purpose of this channel is to spread the knowledge and knowing wherever it is possible. So I will just also request it, especially the medical students and doctors, that you please ask your friends to subscribe it as well. You can subscribe this channel by going to YouTube and then type Surgeon Javed 1, SurgeonJaved1. And so it's a single word. And when you type it, you get our channel, which is From Knowledge to Knowing. I'm also planning to make a dedicated website, but it will take about 6 to 8 months, where I would like to put all the clinical surgery on that website and all those lectures. And there is no paucity of these material in the net. You can find it out. But I feel that the original feel of a lecture using this board with the students, which actually is the classical way of imparting novel in a model where you get direct information and knowledge and attitude from a teacher, that actually requires to be further promoted. And I plan to do that. So thank you very much for your watching. We will continue it. Thank you.